Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our service of worship and celebration of the life of Lowell Peterson, Jr. On behalf of Lisa and of Lorraine and all of the Peterson family, I want to thank you for your attendance today. There will be a luncheon following the service, and after the luncheon, the burial will take place at Lake Jenny Covenant Church. On behalf of the family and also Lake Jenny Covenant Church, we want to thank the Dassel Covenant Church here for the use of their facilities today and all of the assistance they have given in planning and organizing the day's events. Remember this. Dying Christ destroyed our death. Rising Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in glory, just as through faith Lowell was united with Christ in Christ's death, so Lowell certainly will be united with Christ in his resurrection. Here and now, dear friends, we are God's children. What we shall be has not been yet revealed. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure. Let us pray. Gracious God and Father, may your Spirit fill this place. May your presence that was so evident in the life of your servant Lowell be felt by each of us. Even in our grief and tears, may we know that because of Jesus and his victory over death, this is also a day of hope. A day we can rejoice that the one whose life we remember is now in your presence. We are thankful that you are with us, and we dedicate this service of worship to you, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We will now sing in your worship folder, What a Day That Will Be.
Thank you. I've been asked by the family to do the scripture reading. The first scripture is Romans chapter 12, verses 9 through 21. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving in the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in all in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, It is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The second reading is from Revelations chapter 21, verses 1 through 7. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them, and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain. For the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children.
Son of Lowell Oscar and Lorraine Elsie Elizabeth Berquis Peterson, was born on February 10, 1945, in Cokato, Minnesota. Lowell grew up in the Lake Jenny area, where he was baptized and later confirmed at the Lake Jenny Evangelical Covenant Church. He graduated from the Dassel High School in 1963. On May 2, 1970, Lowell was united in marriage to Lorraine O'Fallon at the Assembly of God Church in Hutchinson. Together, they made their home on the shores of Lake Jenny. He was a hard worker and a wonderful father and husband. He farmed, drove truck, and found enough time to restore antique tractors and pickups. He was a social person and enjoyed striking up a conversation with a stranger. But by the end of the conversation, a new friendship was born. He loved to play cards and could often be found watching movies with his daughter, Lisa. And I know that one of those was always Farlap, right? He loved his family with his whole heart and enjoyed the times he could spend together for holidays and special events. They enjoyed spending time on a pontoon and sitting beside a bonfire. He loved spending time with friends and family. He was so happy to gain his son-in-law, Patrick, and enjoyed many fun games of Wii bowling when they got together. But most of all, he loved his Savior and trusted him throughout his life, in hard times and in times of blessing. He will be deeply missed by his family. especially enjoyed time with his twin brother Steve, just sitting in the shop talking while having a pop. One had a Pepsi, one had a Coke. He is survived by his wife, Lorraine Peterson of Dassel, daughter Lisa and Patrick Selchert of Dassel, siblings Steve and Bonnie Peterson of Dassel, Arlene and David Grieve of Dassel, Wendy and Jeff Roush of Dassel, Mary Beth and Tom Reynolds of Dassel, and Nancy and Charles Green of Spicewood, Texas. Sister-in-law Marcia Peterson of Hudson, Wisconsin. And he is also survived by numerous nieces, nephews, and other relatives. He was preceded in death by his daughter Kimberly Peterson, his parents Lowell Sr. and Lorraine Peterson, and a brother Michael Peterson. And now Lisa's going to come up and give some remembrances, and then after that we're going to have a short time if anyone is interested. We'll have a microphone, or you're certainly welcome to come up here, and if you have a memory you'd like to share, we'd love to hear those too. Thank you.
Then King David went in and sat before the Lord, and he said, "Who am I, have the same legs. We're physically the same size and have the same looks, in case other of you hadn't noticed. We both worked in bridge construction. We both had our hand at farming. We both worked in a body shop. Then we also both loved driving trucks. We were able to, once in a while, take a truck trip together. This was a wonderful bonding time for both of us. We were always able to share things with each other. In the later years, we both enjoyed fixing and restoring things. For the little of us, mostly tractors and pickups and cars. When we were younger, I am sure we kept Mom and Dad in total suspense. It is the three of us, Lowell, Mike, and I. We were very creative when we were younger. What one didn't think of, the other one would. At the time we were too young and too small to drive, we thought we should take a ride in the family car around the house. One of us would stand on the seat and steer, behind the floor to do the starter on the floor, while the other one was just along for the ride. Unfortunately, we didn't get too far, and we did run into the house. Now, with my brothers, there were a few things we didn't agree on. A few things that come to mind are like old light, down here lawnmowers, while I like up cadet and Kubota. When it came to vehicles, Lowell liked Fords and I preferred a Chevy. The one big one was he was a Colt man and I preferred a Pepsi myself. We did respect each other's likes and loved each other very much. In the later years, when we both were retired, we enjoyed getting together for a pop and a candy bar, which we both always had in our shops. We would just sit and visit and share how blessed we were to live where we do, and we're able to see each other so often. The visits got a little longer when a birthday was involved, and we invited a few more friends over to celebrate. We weren't rich in earthly things, but we're fortunate to have had our whole family close by and had a Mom and Dad who brought us up in a very Christian home. We were taught to try and be kind and to love everyone, even though our prayers for a miracle to restore Lowell's health wasn't answered the way we wanted. I know that God had a plan and will use this to touch a life in a way we are not aware of. I will miss him deeply, but knowing that he is with the Lord makes all the difference in the world. Please keep our family in your prayers. If you have family close by and are able to give them a hug and tell them how much you love them, give them a call and let them know you are thinking of them. Life here on earth is short. It is short, and you never know when they will end. Be gone. But when I was out there looking at him and I put my head up his heart, he stole my heart. I know that I have your God.
I can get through this because I'm one of those people that cries kind of easy. When I think back, for those of you who don't know, the Peterson family was my first cousins. And it's kind of unique to speak here. Well, Mike's funeral a number of years ago now, and now we're celebrating Lowell's. And about five, well, I forget how many years ago, I lost one of my twin sisters. So it's kind of unique in a way. But I think back to when we were all growing up, and I spent hours out at the Peterson house. Every Christmas vacation, every Easter vacation, most of the summer, and we would pick up bales and whatnot. And like Steve was saying, what one didn't think of, the other one did. And some of them were almost life-threatening. And I also reflect back on the days I spent hours in Lowell's shop. He and I did share one thing. I like Coke also. And we would talk about what he was remodeling or whatever, restoring, and what was going on in our separate lives. And at times it would we would reflect on our beliefs in the living God and what he meant to us. And so Lowell would be sorely missed. And it loved him very much.
Thank you all for those memories. Let us pray together. O God, our strength and our Redeemer, giver of life and conqueror of death, we praise you with humble hearts. With faith in your great mercy and wisdom, we entrust Lowell to your eternal care. We praise you for your steadfast love for him all the days of his earthly life. We thank you for all that he was to those who loved him. We thank you that for Lowell all sickness and sorrow are ended, and death itself is past, and he has entered the home where all your people gather in peace. Keep us all in communion with your faithful people in every time and place, that at last we may rejoice together in the heavenly family where Jesus Christ reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. We're going to sing our second hymn, Mansion Over the Hilltop.
Oh,
just sang about the mansion over the hilltop. When we heard the scripture read from Revelation, we heard the glory of a new heaven and a new earth, the holy city of Jerusalem. And of course, in the last week, we've discussed much the comfort we get from knowing that Lowell is now with God in heaven. In a time of loss, of course, we always think about what is the reward, what is the next thing that's going to happen. And as I thought about this week, and thinking about what was important to Lowell, I wanted to take a step back this morning and think about why? Why? Why do we have so much to look forward to? Why is there such a promise made to us? Remember in the Gospel of John, when Jesus was meeting with his disciples at the Last Supper, he said to them, "I'm going to go prepare a place for you in my Father's house. There are many rooms." And the disciples' question was, well, you know, how do we get there? How do we get to that? And that's what I want to think about here today. How do we get to that place? Because we know we certainly can't get there by our own efforts. We certainly can't get there by our own abilities here in this world. So as I've been thinking about it this week, I wanted to think about heaven and how it becomes something that is available to us as the people of God. And I was drawn back to the Gospel of John in chapter 3, the verses, probably the first verses almost any of us learn in our faith. Verse 16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." Our salvation and our reward begins with the love that God has for his people. The love he has shown in creation, in the beauty of this earth, and the promises that he has made for us. We see his love in creation. We see his love in the garden as he dwelt with Adam and Eve, and we know the brokenness that came from their rebellion, and the brokenness that still comes from our rebellious spirit. We know that we were sundered from God, separated from him, with no promise of a future. But God loved us so much that he needed to repair that breach, to build a bridge between himself and us. And in so doing, he chose to use his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. He sent him so that we shall not perish, but have eternal life. And so God was made manifest. God was made incarnate in this world in the person of Jesus Christ. And the thing that is always amazing to me is the fact that God became flesh. He became one of us. I recently listened to a long book going through a lot of the old Greek mythology and the Greek ideas. And one of the things I saw there and in my study of other ancient religions is I never find a time when a god is born. Gods burst from their fathers' heads. They come from people's sides. Gods always come with full power, glory, and majesty. But not our Savior, Jesus Christ. He comes as a babe in a manger. He comes facing all of the difficulties and all of the challenges that we face in life. He is not a distant God. He is a God that has become one with us. For every human being, we know that there is birth, we know that there is life, and we know that at some point death will come. But birth and death for a God? That's something that had not been heard of. That's something that was not part of the traditions and the beliefs of most people in the world. Because after being born a babe in a manger, Jesus Christ grew up, and he lived, and he taught, and he worked amongst us, and people knew him. God made person. And in the end, he does the other thing that a God almost never does. He faces death. And not a quiet, peaceful death, but the death on a cross. But in doing all of these things, God identifies himself with us. Our experience of birth, our experience of life, our experience of death becomes his experience. In the book of Hebrews, it says that Christ is our righteous judge because he has experienced all that we have experienced. John 3:16 says, God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. And the Son loved us so much that he was willing to come and live as one of us and to be one of us, to be born, to live, and to die. But of course, as much as Christ became incarnate and came and spoke to us, he was also still God. And so he was able to do something that we could not do for ourselves. He was able to pay the penalty for our sins. He was able to redeem us so that we can look forward to the promise. And as Scripture tells us, not only that, but he conquered death and became the firstborn from the dead. We can only have the happy promise of a future life because Christ came and dwelt among us and lived for us and defeated death and became the firstborn of the resurrection and giving us the promise of resurrection also. So the pattern has been changed. There is birth for us, there is life for us, there is death for us, and there is resurrection for us. But resurrection to what? The passage we read from Revelation 21, 1 through 7, ended with the great line, those who are victorious will inherit in all of this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. But think there at the beginning, those who are victorious. We left off because it's a little bit downbeat. Verses 8, 9, and 10 and go, but about everybody else? There's suffering, there's pain, there's hell. Resurrection is guaranteed to all. The kingdom of heaven is not. There is another thing that comes into play in what we do here in our life. And that was made clear earlier in John chapter 3. In 16 he says, for God so loved the world. But earlier when he's talking to Nicodemus in this chapter, Nicodemus is asking him about what one needs to do. And Jesus says this, very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. Unless they are born again. You probably remember Nicodemus is confused by this. Nicodemus goes, well, how do I go back into my mother's womb? How do I get born again? And Jesus tells him, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. And this is the big difference between those who have hope and those who don't have hope, is the question of whether or not they have had that second birth. Whether or not they have accepted the Lord and Savior as being the Lord of their life. Whether they have committed themselves to live as Christ has called them to live. Have they received the Holy Spirit that God has promised to his children? So Lowell, like all humans, knows the promise of birth, the promise of life, the promise of death, and the promise of resurrection. But he also carries with him, and everyone who I have spoken to this week is attested to this, that he also had the new birth and the second birth. The second birth that inaugurates you not into this world, but into the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven. Lowell lived within the kingdom of heaven. In his faithfulness to his family, in his faithfulness to the church, and in his love for others. As I was thinking about what passage I wanted read this week, I always try and think of what is there unique about the person I'm speaking to. And on Monday, when we were at the funeral home and I heard Steve speaking, I'll paraphrase what Steve said. It was kind of to the idea that Lowell could talk to anyone and he could make friends with anyone. And that's what led me to pick the Romans passage that we heard earlier today. And particularly verse 18 stood out to me. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. And as I've talked to Lowell and as I've known Lowell for these last 23 years, I cannot think of anyone that Lowell spent any significant amount of time on the outs with. He could make friends, he could talk with people, he could share with people. Now, certainly there were times when resentment, there were times of conflict, there were times of disagreement. But yet Lowell would never let those things interfere with the continuation of a relationship, because relationship was at the heart of who he was. In the Romans passage, Romans 12, it says, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. If we have salvation because it's rooted in the love that God has for us, what he has called to us in our rebirth is to love one another just as we love God. It's a challenging thing we're asked to do. In verse 20 of this passage, it says, on the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will keep burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. I remember one time I was talking to Lowell about someone he knew. And this person was living a lifestyle that perhaps was not the Christian lifestyle, was perhaps not the way to live. And I asked Lowell then, well, how then do you relate to this person? And his answer was, you love them. You stay in relationship with them. Because if you don't stay in relationship, you can't affect their life and you can't make a change. The mansion on the hilltop, the glorious city of God, the gates of heaven. All of these things are things that have been made possible by God's love for us. All of these things are made possible for us by the sacrifice of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. All of these things are made possible for us by the power of the Holy Spirit who dwells within us and makes us into a new creation, not just in death, but also in life. So this day we give thanks to God for his deep abiding love, both as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we give thanks for the opportunity to respond in faith, to declare ourselves to not live for just ourselves, but rather live for the kingdom of God. And in living for the kingdom of God, to love him with all our heart and all our soul and all our mind, and love our neighbor as ourselves. And as I think of Lowell, there's nothing I can think of more than the idea that if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. May we all find peace in our Lord and Savior. May we all find peace in Lowell's memory, now and always. Amen. I would invite you to turn in your worship folder to the affirmation of faith that is printed in the order of worship. Let us read this together as our own affirmation of faith, as our own claim upon the gift that God has given us. We believe there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And we know that in everything God works for good with those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. We are sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ. Jesus our Lord. Amen. We're now going to sing again our third and final hymn, Isn't the Love of Jesus Something?